Hello everyone, so today we are gathered to discuss the infamous Queen of Air and Darkness by Cassandra Clare. If you guys haven't read this book, please leave. Know that I loved it. I cried in it. I loved it. Did I cry as much as I cried in Lord of Shadows? No, I didn't. But I still cried nonetheless. And I still love all these characters. I gave it 5 out of 5 stars because I'm trash for these characters. And I enjoyed it a lot. I had so much fun annotating it and whatnot. My only regret with reading this book is that I read it in 2019. The continuation series to this book comes out in 2022. So, but anyways, yeah, that's kind of my non-spoilery section. Yeah, go away now. Go away. Now for the spoilery section for the rest of the review, I'm going to be talking and breaking things up into scenes and relationships and topics that I want to talk about. We're going to go kind of in chronological order, but not really. And I guess I would just want to say I'm really happy that Cassandra Clare decided to start the book off immediately after Lord of Shadows. I really loved how we got to see everything pan out. I loved how as the Blackthorn children were like whisked away and they were together as a family, we have Emma and Christina and all these outsiders from the family, like how they coped with it and how grief was demonstrated throughout the whole series. I loved how Christina took Emma under her wings and called her Corazoncito, I think. That was just so cute. I love him so much. We see Julian get a spell done. We have Julian at the funeral. So Julian at the funeral, he was so mean. He told Mark to shut up. He didn't pick up Tabby. He, like, other than him going after Ty, he was just so rude, so mean, so emotionless that I didn't even know how to, because I feel bad for Julian. I honestly feel bad. Like, he lost one of his children, essentially. It's hard, but at the same time, I'm like, you don't have to be mean. Like, we don't need you to be mean. We already have the cohort to be mean. And honestly, talking about the cohort and Horace and Zara, they are just so dumb. Horace especially. I can't remember where it was that he was giving this speech and he was talking, he gave this quote about why Shadowhunters should be first. And I'm going to read that quote because I was just so taken back and I tapped it. It's a light green tab because I thought it was hilarious. What kind of, why would you? And it says, we must remember the Shadowhunters were chosen. We must remember that we are the mandate. We stand first in the face of evil and therefore we come first. And to me, that made no sense. If you stand first in the face of evil, meaning you're first, the first line of defense, your job is to defend, meaning you do not come first. If anything, the people you're defending come first. You are last. He just said a lot of dumb things. I don't know. I just think throughout the whole series, Cassandra Clare took jabs at current governments in the world. Did I enjoy it? I have to say, yes, I did. I did enjoy it. So getting the funeral scene out of the way, I'm going to go into the scene where they're in Fairy, the throne scene, where we have all the Shadowhunters come into the picture. Can I just say, I've never been more happy in my life to see the Seelie Queen. I just couldn't help but clap for her. She has so much power. I didn't even think she was that powerful. She was scary. She's a scary mother, honestly. Yeah, she just took on everyone. And throughout this whole scene, I was so scared. I was so scared for everyone. I thought for sure someone was going to die. Like, they can't possibly make it out of here alive. We see Annabelle. Ugh, I thought we were gonna kill Annabelle. So my beef with Annabelle is quite simple. She killed Livy. She left Ty alone. She left the hole in the Blackthorns. I loved Livy. And for her to just kill her. And then she said, I didn't mean to. What do you mean? You literally her. You stabbed her. And she was so annoying. Like, first with Ash, protecting Ash. She's the reason they went into Thule. And Thule, we're gonna talk about Thule. But also in this scene, we have Christina and Emma again. Another moment, another one of my favorite moments. I love how Christina and Emma are just like the bestest friends ever. Like, they're literally talking. I think it's Adion. He's like, no, shut up. Shut up. He's like, no, we're separating both of you. Because they keep giggling and just laughing. And it just reminds me so much of me and my friends. And it was so good. It was so good. And on the topic of Christina and Emma, there's also a quote towards the end of the book where Emma's like, I wish I could have met her when she was like younger and full of mischief and stuff. And I was like, I wish you could have met her too. You guys would have been best friends. You could have been the best pair of a tie. Not the best. I mean, Will and Jim. But you could have, you're good. Okay. So going back to the scene that we were talking about. So Annabelle took Ash to Thule, which I was like, okay, well, he's gone, but whatever. And then Emma and Julian went into Thule. And as I turned the page and it says Thule, and we're going to get like a chapter on it, I thought it was just going to be a chapter. It was like 100 and something pages. I've heard people say like this is one of their favorite parts of the book. Not mine. Not mine. I have to say it's not mine. I could have done a little bit without that much chunk of it. I found it interesting that we got to see like old characters, people who have died and stuff like that. Livy, my girl Livy. But I, for some reason, Kurien's voice kept telling me, remember, it's not real. And I was just like, thank you, Kurien. Thank you. Thank you. I just couldn't take it as seriously as I should have, I think. I wanted to go back to my characters. I wanted to go back to Christine and Mark, back to Ty and Kit, back to Dru, back to all these other characters. All that being said, I did enjoy it overall. I just wasn't expecting it to be like a full little book in a book. And now I'm going to talk about some of the things that I saw in Thule that I just want to talk to people about. So the first one is Cassie defends Clary in Thule. We'd see how if Clary hadn't been there, how all these things would have panned out and how we would have gotten Thule. And I thought it was greatly done. I think that Clary's not giving as much credit as a hero. And it's really nice to see Cassandra Clare defend her. And then we see Ash and... Ash, this boy. So Ash in this dimension is 17 because it's been some years or something. At least that's how Emma sees him now, as like 17. I don't know how to feel about Ash. Like I think he has potential to be good. He's potential to be a good king or whatever, but he's not guided by the best people. And it, apparently it's like he doesn't show emotion except for one person, and that is Dru. I love this girl so much. I feel like she came into her own. I loved being in her head. I loved the things she expressed. There was a thought she had that said how with people, and she was talking, I think, about Kurien, you see different bits of them, like their humor, their bravery, their selflessness, their love and stuff, and that's how you begin to understand. And she wondered if anyone would ever see that much of her and understand her, and that was so beautiful. True. And we have Ash in this book, and I just think like this kid is a robot because it just doesn't seem like he has any feelings whatsoever. So here we have where Ash is saying it was her, the strange human girl he once seen in the Unsealed Weapons Room. Dark hair, eyes the color of the sky, he only partially remembers.
Drusilla, she looked lonely, Ash thought, but determined as well, as if hope lived behind those summer blue eyes, a hope that could not be quenched by loss, a hope too strong to feel despair. And then it goes on to say, Ash's heart was pounding, though he could not have said why. Hastily, he folded the drawing and thrust it into his pocket.
So I'm just going to go into it. I'm just going to go into Ash and Dru and Jaime, because why not? So I feel like he likes Dru, and I don't know how I feel about this, because I love Dru, obviously. But in Lord of Shadows, we met this character, Jaime. People have been calling him Jamie, but I call him the way I would if, like, he spoke Spanish. You know what I'm saying? Anyways, that's the part. The point is that Ash, Jaime, and Dru. I ship Dru and Jaime. Like, they've watched movies together. They lived in the same room together. They are my ship. Jaime carries her when he first sees her at the beach. And then one of my favorite scenes in the book is when everyone's discovering that Jaime was slept in Dru's room. I love Mark's reaction. I love how Ty is like, why is Mark doing this? And Kit is like, he's protecting her honor. I just love that scene so much. So after that, I was like, maybe he likes her. I don't know. And then my love for him just solidified when Dru, like being a badass that she is, goes and picks a lock and bails out everyone from jail, all the shadow hunters who were in the jail and the guard. And Jaime, before he goes in the field, he grabs her hand, he goes up to her, and he's like, I will be thinking of you in the battlefield. And I'm just like dying because I love him so much. He's so funny. There's another scene where he lays across all the seats to save them for the Blackthorns. I love him. And at the end, when he's like telling Dru, like, oh, what's your plans for the academy? And he realizes that she's not of age, and he has this pain expression afterwards. I think it's because he genuinely likes her, and he's pained because there's an age gap, which is like 4 years. 4 years is not that much. I think, like, if he's 28 and she's 24, like, what? I don't know. I ship them so hard. And people say, like, oh, well, Drusilla's just 13. Yeah, she is just 13, but she's a very mature 13-year-old. And Jaime's a very immature 70-year-old, in that he doesn't carry himself like Diego. You know, Diego's, like, real serious. And he's gonna go to the academy. And we'll talk about that later in my theory section for the Wicked Powers. But yeah, that's my spiel. Oh, and then this actually fits here. Ash, after the whole shebang is done and they're going back, like Julian and Emma are going back to our regular dimension, he takes Jace and flies away with him. I thought that was so funny. Just imagine a kid with wings just swoop this other bigger kid and just flies away with him. I thought that was hilarious. I love that. Okay, let's discuss Libby. So in this dimension, we have Libby and she's like a bad A and she's taking care of everyone and she's dating Cameron, which is just... Oh, this kid, it's just so sad. This kid can never get a break. He just has a shit destiny and Thule dies. And then he has a shit family in our regular dimension. And I just feel so bad for him. So, Libby. So, I liked her. I thought she was good. I just didn't like her as my Libby. I wanted my Libby back. I didn't want whoever this girl was. Like, she's great. She's amazing. She has the values that Libby had. But Libby was a sunshine. She was a rainbow of sunshine. And when Julian was like, we'll bring you back, it's like, she's not going to fill the void that is Libby. She's not our Libby. And Ty understood that. Ty understood that well. And Julian came to understand that. But Libby's letter to Ty, can we just... That's the reason I cried. Libby's letter to Ty. He's like, you're a twinless twin. And I, in your world, I'm the lucky one because I don't have to live without you. And it was just so sad. And at the end, it's like, I love you, I love you, and I love you. That broke my heart so much. And even now talking about it, I want to cry because it's just so beautiful. And then Ty just doesn't even take it into account. And I'm just like, you dumb fool. And then finally, let's talk about Annabelle in school because that's how she meets her end. I wanted her gone. And she died. But through all of it, we see that Annabelle comes out in a meeting where Horace is talking to Manuel and Zara. And Annabelle's in the corner. And I was just freaking out. I was just freaking out. I could not trust anyone. Like, literally in all the chapters towards the end, in the final battle, I was a mess.
Like, when Magnus was hanging back near the trees, probably to secure, like, Kit and Ty, I was like, why is he hanging over there? Is Annabelle over there? Has he met Annabelle already? When Jace was hitting people with the back of the blade, is that really Annabelle? Is that not Jace? When Kit and Ty were left in the forest alone, I was scared of Annabelle. And it turned out to be a demon, and I was like, God bless. God bless.
Because that girl, she needed to go. Now I'm gonna go into the last part of the book and talk about kind of the final scene, but also about topics that I've been wanting to discuss, like the Parabatai bond. Let's talk about the Parabatai bond. So the Parabatai bond, I love the Parabatai bond. And honestly, when I was reading this book, Cassie was like making it seem like it was a bad thing. Diana said it was bad, like it had corruption at its core. The Seely Queen said it was bad. Jem was like, you can't fall in love. Magnus was like, you can't fall in love. And I was like, no, this cannot be real. Will and Jem, they're Parabatai, they're good, they're amazing. What? No. And I refused to believe it. Towards the end, when Emma had her, like, I wouldn't say breakdown, but like that scene of just desperation where she just wanted things to be okay, where she knew like she wasn't going to harm other people and she was willing to go slash the bond. One, I was scared. I thought she was actually going to do it. And I'm happy that Julian was the one who was like, no, you have to have faith in what's good, basically. And I just love that. Another scene where Emma was just like creeping me out a bit. I mean, you expect creepiness from Julian, like you expect him to be like ruthless and just heartless, but you could honestly see how much Emma has gone through, how much pain she has, how much like just grief and how much she's in despair. In the scene also where she just wants Cortana back and Zara's there and they're fighting and she almost kills Zara and she doesn't, and then later it came back to stab her in the back, literally. Okay, so now I'm just gonna talk about the ending because why not. I'm just going to name it from the campfire scene to the end of the book is the ending, kind of, for me. So in the ending, we have Ty try to raise Libby, and I knew he was going to do that. Like, he's not gonna back down. Like, it's Ty. Which, should I just talk about Ty and Kit? Yeah, why not? Because Ty and Kit, they're my favorites. They, in this book, my favorite characters are Ty, Kit, and Dru. Jaime. Ty, Kit, and Dru. Jaime. You guys have no idea how much I fangirled for Tai and Kit. So the first page I fangirled was 205, and it's when they're sitting together, and I think they're on top of the roof or something, and Tai brushes Kit's hair out of his face, out of his eyes, and people would just be like, oh, he was probably, you know, brushing it away because, you know, it's the nice thing to do, I guess. But in my eyes, I like to think that Tai did it because he wanted to look at Kit's eyes and his hair was in the way, which doesn't make sense because Tai doesn't really look at anyone directly. But I just fell in love with that scene. And then the second scene was page 352, and that is when Tai willingly, without any other influence other than his want to, hugs Kit. It was so beautiful. It was so... Can I just read you that page? Yes, I am. I'm going to read you that page real quick. I even, like, I highlighted it so much. Kit stood breathless, the water receding around him as Tai came up and put his arm around Kit's neck. Yeah, I'm just going crazy. And says he remembered holding Tai on the roof of the institute in London, but that had been because Tai was panicking. It had been like holding a wild animal. This was Tai hugging him because he wanted to. The soft cloth of Tai's shirt, the feel of Tai's hair brushing against his cheek as he hid his expression from Tai by burying his face against the other boy's shoulder. He could hear Tai's breathing. He threaded his arm around Tai, crossing his cold hands over Tai's back when Tai leaned into him with a sigh. He felt like in a water race. He didn't even know he was running. Oh my god, it was so freaking beautiful. And I shook him so hard.
So of course I was devastated when, especially and elated when Kit told like Tai, don't raise her and I love you. I love Kit said I love you and he was crying. Kit doesn't cry. Kit doesn't say I love you. Kit is the boy who goes around the institute talking about how much he hates shadow hunters. And Tai. Tai proceeds on to say later on, like in the scene, Livy, without you, there is nothing worth living for. It was something like that. And I was just like,
God damn it, Tai. God damn it. You had one job. And because of that, we then see Kit decide to stay with Jem and Tessa. And honestly, in the scene, I was kind of conflicted. I wanted him to go back to Tai. But personally, when I was reading all that he was saying, like, this could be a new fresh start for him. He can learn. He could be his own person. He can figure out who he wants to be. I was so happy for him. I was so proud of him. I love Kit so much. And I'm so excited for him to be with Jem and Tessa. I wanted him to go with Jem and Tessa. I wanted him to see his own worth. And I feel like Jem and Tess are just like A-list parents, bro. And I'm happy for him. I'm sad that they're not gonna be together for some time. I'm so sad when Tai was like, he keeps asking for Kit and then like no one tells him. And Magnus just goes on saying like, bro, he doesn't want to talk to you. And I was just like, oh my god, Magnus, please don't. Not to Tai. He's just so heartbroken. I just couldn't. And then Tai says that, can I just talk to him? Can I just say goodbye to him? If I could just talk to him once? Why? What are you gonna say to him, Tai? Why? Are you gonna tell him you love him? If it's not an I love you, I don't want to hear it. I don't want to hear it. Do you see how invested I am in these characters? Like, I love Tai and Kit together forever. Ship them. Let's just go back to the scene. So then we have the scene and Cortana comes back to Emma and the source of the sky all magically like, and I thought that was beautiful. We have them fight, we have the Wild Hunt join in, we have all the downworlders just join in, and it's such a beautiful scene. A horrific scene, but a beautiful scene nonetheless. And we have Kyrian finally being like, oh my god, Kyrian. Can I just say, if he hadn't said, I want to duel with you, we could have just avoided a lot of the bloodshed. Let's just talk about the real tea here. And this is Emma and Julian. So Emma and Julian, they become these huge monsters, these huge light beam angel looking things. And everyone's like, and I'm just like, well, I thought personally that there's going to be bigger consequences for what happened. I thought that for sure their marks were going to be stripped, that one was going to be exiled. I thought the last picture, the picture with Emma and Julian on the beach, because I've seen that one on Pinterest before, was going to be them in exile without their family. And I thought that would have been like a more like the heart impactful thing. I did overall like the way it ended. I think it was good. I think she left us with like a good happy ending. Honestly, even though that happened with the ending, I still mourn the book because Kit and Tai and Dru and Jaime, because Drew's not going to talk to Jaime for some time and Kit and Tai are separated, and to me that hurt more. But overall, I'm really happy with how the book ended. We have Alec and Magnus and their wedding, and that was beautiful. In this scene, we have Kyrian come back, and I so let's just talk about Cutie and Christina and Mark for 1 second. So these three, in Lord of Shadows, I was like, oh my god, are they gonna get together? Like, all three of them are gonna get together. I was really loving how Kyrian and Christina were, like, becoming attracted to each other. And honestly, in this book, Kyrian just shook me to my core in one of the scenes. He's, like, he's being healed by Christina, and he's just being so blunt about his emotions. When Mark leaves, and Kyrian just with Christina, he says, why, like, they're talking about how he gets hurt all the time, and he says, that must be why, when I suffer, I long for your touch. And I was just like, whoa, Gary, that's a little, that's really direct. And then, literally, some sentences later, he says, I thought of you every time anyone used Diego's name, Rosales. I cannot stop thinking of you. And I was just like, okay, okay. And then finally, he says, princess, you'll be better off without me. He calls her princess again. And I just really overall really liked them together. I thought, like, Kyrian and Mark, they say, like, the most beautiful things in the world. And I love them so much. And I love how Christina is with them and how they welcomed her in and how they are just a family together. At the end, when he does come back to the scene with the wedding and all, that broke my heart because it's described as Kyrian just seems just, like, king-like, eerie and beautiful and, like, just distant overall. And I was like, oh my god, my boy is growing to up to be a king. And
it's so why am I just dying
because of Kintai. But I'm really excited to see where their relationship will go. Do I want to talk about anyone else's relationship? I love Jace and Kit's relationship. Oh my god, they're so good together. I adore how Jace is like, can I call you Christopher? And he's like, no, Christopher. I love that scene. I loved when he's like, are you ready for battle, Kit? And Kit's like, ugh. And Magnus is like, you will not touch any of my kits, you Herondo. I loved how Jace was so serious about finding him a weapon and he gives him a Herondo dagger. Oh. And honestly, I want to see them together in the Wicked Powers. I want to see them fighting and training together. I want to see Jace helping Kit out. I want to see it all. I want them to have such a great connection because I love them so much. I think Jace is very, like, they have, like, the same humor, sarcastic humor, but Jace is, because he's older, he's, like, playing around with Kit, and Kit's, like, not having it, and I love it so much. And Kit loves him. I know he loves him because he thought of Jace and of his mother when he decided to take on the Herondo name, so... So before I go into my theory section, I just want to go into MVP section. Basically, most... valuable player in the book. So I just have to say my first MVP goes to Office Max. Yes, because he, Office Max, that printer just saved everyone's butt by printing the black book. It brought a lot of humor to the book, so Office Max, thank you to you. And then the second one goes to Shade because he's a real one. I love how he comes out at the end and helps Magnus, and he got Ragnar Lives shirt. Like, that was the best. And then we have Aline. Oh my god, Aline. I love this girl so much. She's just so abrasive, so caring still, just so authoritarian. Love her attitude and how she stands straight and she has this confidence about her. And I love how Aline can make her blush. I just thought she was a really bad A. And then who else is in MVP in the series? Diana and Gwen. Let's talk about Diana and Gwen. So I thought for sure Gwen was going to die. I thought for sure Gwen was gonna die, but they didn't. I'm happy they stayed together. I'm just really happy that they came together and they're still together. The last one is Raphael, because I loved how he rejected the fact that Magnus named their kid after him. Even when they're leaving, he says, like, make sure Magnus changes the name or, like, removes it. And I just love him so much. So anyways, those are the people I want to just shout out because they're amazing. Finally, I'm going to talk about my theories for the Wicked Powers. We, throughout all the series, we have seen that every series has at least one pair of a tie couple. I would like to predict the one, the Wicked Powers. So based on the ending, I think one possible couple could be Jaime and Kit. Why? You might ask. My first reason is because they're both going to go to the academy. I'm pretty sure Kit is going to go to the academy. I think he said it. And then Jaime is for sure going to the academy. So they'll meet. They'll be funny together. I love these boys. These are my boys. Or we could have Kit and Dru because they're both very similar to each other. And I like that. And again, Dru is probably going to go to the academy as well. And then I already talked about Ash, Dru, and Jaime. Honestly, if they get together, I really want Jaime to be with Dru right now. But I have a feeling that Ash and Dru are going to end up together. And Jaime is going to, like, get killed or something. I know. It's, like, blasphemy because I love Jaime so much. But the way Ash was talking about her, it just sounds like love, you know? It sounds like there's going to be a thing. And that thing is going to be powerful. So let's talk about that epilogue. Ash and the fake Jace. I really was like, really? Really? We're gonna get fake Jace to bring in Clary and Jace again? Like, am I on the right for it? Of course I am. Of course I am on the right for it. But like, why, Ash? Why did you have to bring this Jace? And then I want to talk about Kit, Ash, and Kyrian. So all these three, Kyrian is currently king of the Unseelie court. Ash is too powerful, too freaking powerful. He's kind of scary. So he would have claim over the Seelie court because he's the queen's son. But then we have Kit, who is the descendant of the first heir, so he would have real claim to both courts. And I don't know how powerful Kit is, but he seemed pretty powerful, so I'm actually really excited to see that whole dynamic, who would go over who. I think Kyrian should go back with Christina and Mark and leave his duty. I think Ash should just be the king of everything and be a good king. And then Kit should just go back to Ty, of course. Like, why are we like scrambling? And then Jaime and Dru can be together. Done. That's not how it's gonna happen, because we all know Cassandra Clare, and that's not gonna happen. And then finally, and then I put Scholomance in the academy, and basically what I'm trying to say here is that I can't wait to see Kit and Ty see each other again. I can't wait to have them together again. I can't wait for them to like be like, oh my god, I haven't seen him in like this many years and he's so cute. And finally, I would like to know what happens up with like the rest of the characters, like what happens with Emma and Julie and Christina and all of these other characters, and how they're going to be coming back into the book. And overall, those are all my thoughts. I hope you guys enjoyed it, guys. I'm so psyched. 2022 cannot come sooner. I love it so much. I can't wait to see more of Kit and Ty, Dru and Jaime. I love Jaime so much. I really enjoyed the representation, the Mexican representation in the book overall. I liked how people were scared of Christina's mom, because that's so real. Like, I guess if you guys didn't know, I'm Mexican. Like, seeing my culture in a book, it was just so nice to see, and see it so well like represented. I think just like the loyalty and the family aspect of it all, like I could completely relate to that. And her culture, family is such a big important thing, and especially loyalty to that family. And then also I really liked how Christina's mom was scary to everyone, because honestly moms are great scary. Like, I'm scared of my mom. I love the book overall. I gave it 5 out of 5 stars. I hope you guys leave down your thoughts below on what do you guys think. Who do you guys ship? Do you guys ship Dru with Jaime or Dru with Ash? I don't know. Honestly, as long as my girl's happy, I'm happy. Leave down your comments, and I'll talk to you guys later. Bye.